Jacob Brooks to come forward this morning and lead us in a word of prayer.
I got up, you were looking at my
heart. Oh, I was waiting for you to get here. There you go, brother. So, how you doing?
Hallelujah.
Dear Heavenly Father, God, Lord, we come to you in prayer this morning, Lord, just thanking you for another day, blessed day in your house, Heavenly Father, God. Lord, we just ask, Lord, that, Lord, you just fill us up this morning, Lord. Open our hearts and minds to your word, to this worship, Heavenly Father, God, Lord. Lord, we just ask, Lord, that you speak through Brother Farrell as he comes, Lord. Lord, that he will die to self, Father God, Lord, and that you will just fill him up and that you will speak through him, Father God. Lord, we just love you and we just praise you. We just thank you for this time of fellowship today, Father. We love you. It's in your sweet and precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Full of you, and to hear him,
couldn't help but think as they were singing, God has given us a lot of wonderful vocalists and soloists in this church. But I have to confess, none of them compared to this. Out of the mouth of babes comes wisdom. Hey, check your Bibles and turn to John chapter 13. While you're turning there, and I know Doug will enforce this announcement, but guys, you sure want to be here tonight. We're going to have a great time tonight. We're going to have three baptisms.
Amen.
It's always a good thing when the baptismal waters are stirred, because that means somewhere along the way, somebody gave their heart to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So we're going to experience that, and then we're going to hear from Brother Kirk Ware, who just returned from Africa. He's going to share with us just a little bit of what was going on over there. I was hopeful that Velvet would be able to share with him, but she is a little bit under the weather. And then we're going to talk about the future of our church tonight. And so I'm going to strongly encourage you, whether you're a member or a guest, to be here tonight as your pastor shares with you some things that are vital for the future of the ministry of Family Fellowship Baptist Church. So, a lot of good things going on tonight, and I promise you, you won't want to miss it. John chapter 13, verses 1 through 17. I know it's a lengthy passage, but that's all right. Would you stand in honor of the reading of the Word of the Lord? Now before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end.
Amen.
And supper being ended, the devil having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hand, and that he was come from God and went to God, he rises from supper. And he laid aside his garments, and he took a towel, and he girded himself. After that, he poured water in a basin, and began to wash the disciples' feet, and to wipe them with the towel wherewith he was girded. Then cometh he to Simon Peter, and Peter said unto him, Lord, dost thou wash my feet? And Jesus answered and said unto him, What I do, thou knowest not now. Thou shalt know hereafter. Peter said unto him, Thou shalt never wash my feet. Jesus answered him, If I wash thee not, thou hast no part with me. Simon Peter saith unto him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my feet. Jesus said unto him, He that is washed needeth not save to wash his feet, but is clean every whit. And you are clean, but not all, that is every one of you. For he knew who should betray him. Therefore said he, You are not all clean. So after he had washed their feet and taken his garments and was set down again, he said unto them, Know ye not what I have done to you? You call me Master and Lord. And you say, Well, for so I am. If I then, your Master and Lord, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that ye should do as I have done to you. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord, neither he that is sent greater than he that sent him. If you know these things, happy are you if you do them. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, my heart's been blessed this morning to hear the congregation believers lift up their voice in praise to you, to sing adoration to him who is worthy. Oh, Lord, my heart's been blessed to see the little children sing praises to the Lord. And Lord, I'm blessed now, just the privilege of standing here in the midst of this people and preaching the word of the living God. No greater privilege do I know. Lord, I just pray that you take your word today by your Holy Spirit And just begin even now to minister to each one of us. Lord, I'm so thankful that you know our needs as a church and you'll speak to those needs today. But I am even more thankful that you know us as individuals. And you know where we are, what's going on in our lives, what we need to be everything you want us to be. And Lord, you will take your word this morning. And again, by the working of the Spirit of God, you will use that word to give us direction. I just pray, Lord, that we receive grace enough to do what thus saith the Lord. Father, I pray this morning, as always, that you forgive me, that you cleanse me, that you pour me out as a living sacrifice on the altar of heaven, and that you fill me and preach through me the word of the Lord. Have that on, my Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Let me see. Jesus was successful, but not according to the standards of the world. He wasn't on the top 100 list of the wealthiest men in Jerusalem. In fact, he couldn't even pay his taxes, sending Peter to fish for finances. And to make things worse, he chose to live a life of poverty. For he became poor that we through his poverty might be rich. Jesus didn't own a mansion or even a big, big house. By his own admission, the foxes have holes and the sparrows have nests, but the Son of Man had no place to lay his head. Hey, he wasn't even liked all that much. That gives me hope. When given the choice between Jesus and the thief, the crowd cried, "Give us Barabbas." The world would paint an entirely different picture of Jesus. But what I want you to understand this morning is that Jesus was a success. He achieved life, a life of joy unspeakable and full of glory. He succeeded in the acquisition of a peace that passes all understanding. He was content conquering the desires of the flesh. He defeated fear, confident that he could do all things. But his crowning achievement, he finished what he started, receiving the accolades of the Father. "This is my Son, in whom I am well pleased." And for me, that's failed success. Now, today's message is not for everyone. But if you want it said of you by the Father, "This is my child in whom I am well pleased," then follow the example Jesus Christ portrays in this passage. If you want to come to the end, as I do, of your earthly journey, be able to say with the Apostle Paul, "I have fought a good fight, kept the faith, and finished the course. And henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the righteous judge shall give unto me." Then apply what I call the five principles presented in these verses, modeled by the Lord Jesus Christ. First, if you will succeed in life and ministry, you must appreciate the eventuality of life. Scripture says, "Now before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father." This passage clearly reflects a man who knew his time on earth was about to be interrupted. This hour was come that he should depart out of this world unto the Father. Throughout the gospel, Jesus announced to his disciples his impending death, burial, and resurrection. He always knew that his life had boundaries, that there were limitations on time, or as he said, "Work while it is yet day, for the night comes when no man can work." The Lord's success was tied to the reality that there is only so much time to do what has to be done. And therefore, he did what had to be done with the time that he was allotted by the Father. Now, in some ways, Jesus had an advantage over us because he knew the when. We don't. However, we know we will, for it's appointed that a man wants to die. We just don't know the when. Don't place your confidence, my friend, in a tomorrow. For you do not know if tomorrow will ever come for you. And that's why James warns the believer of a misplaced priority. In James chapter 4, verses 13 through 17. Go to now, ye that say, today or tomorrow we will go into such a city and continue there a year and buy and sell and get gain. Whereas you know not what shall be on the morrow. For what is your life? Think about what I'm about to read. It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time. Just a little time. And then vanishes away. For that you ought to say, if the Lord will, we shall live and do this or that. But now you rejoice in your boasting, and all such rejoicing is evil. Therefore, to him that knoweth to do good, and doeth it not, to him it is sin. And that's why the Apostle Paul tells us to value time. His words, redeem the time, for the days are evil. And what he's saying is, buy up every precious moment of time that you can. Time is a priceless commodity, which when gone can never, are you listening to me, can never be retrieved.
Right.
I knew a man, true story, his name was Jim. There were a few days that I didn't see Jim at the church. He was always doing something, always seeking some avenue of service. If there was a need, Jim volunteered. He mowed the yard. He took care of the upkeep on the church building. He served in our benevolence ministry. He taught in Sunday school. He sang in the choir, and he couldn't sing. He drove the van in our church pickup ministry. He raised a large garden and provided the widows and the needy purple hull peas, green beans, corn, tomatoes, cucumbers, watermelons, and cantaloupes. I mean, if there was an activity, Jim was always there. One day, I asked Jim why he was always at the church, always serving. I mean, he had worked all of his life. He had retired. Why? He answered, I wasted 40 years of my life, and now I want to use every opportunity I have to serve my Savior.
Amen.
I asked him to explain what he meant. He said he was saved when he was very young, but as an adult, his priority became his work and his relationships. And he said, for 40 years, I turned my back on the Lord. And I know I can never make up for lost time. But with the life that I have left, I will serve the Lord.
Amen.
I talked to his pastor just a few weeks ago. He said Jim was in extremely bad health, doing dialysis 3 times a week just to stay alive. I said, does he still come to church? The pastor answered, I can't keep him away. He's here every day doing what he can for his Savior. Now listen, time wasted cannot be regained. Please listen to what I just said. Time wasted cannot be regained. But thank God, like Jim, you can use the time you have to serve the blessed Redeemer.
Amen.
In my first pastorate, Madison, Arkansas, I received a call about a young man in the city jail who wanted a visit from the pastor. Now, I don't remember the circumstances of his crime, but what I do remember is what happened. The Holy Spirit spoke to my heart about visiting the young man that night. But I didn't want to go. And I resisted the Spirit saying, tomorrow, Lord, I'll go tomorrow. However, the next day brought news that broke my heart. Sometime during the night, the young man hung himself in his jail cell. Would my visit have made a difference? I don't know. I will never know. What I do know is that I missed my opportunity procrastinating the call of God. Hear me. The time to be saved is now, not tomorrow, for you do not know if tomorrow will ever arrive. The time to serve begins now. Work while it is yet day, for the night comes when you cannot work. The time to do that which is the will of the Lord starts this morning. For your life is like a vapor, here for a brief moment, then quickly vanishes away. The time to share your faith is now. You may not have another chance to share, or they may not have another chance to hear. If you will be successful, like Jesus, you must use your time wisely. Or else you will come to the end of your life only to realize you have left so much undone. And remember this, you're not called to do everything, but to do everything God has called you to do. Now the second principle. If you will succeed in life and ministry, you must accentuate the exercise of love. Jesus knew he would not fail the course because his love would drive him to his destination. Remember the words? Having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them what? Unto the end. Consider the passage in John 1, 10 and 11. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. I mean, listen to the crowds in consideration of that verse. When faced with the decision of whom they would choose, they said, give us Barabbas, crucify him. Feel the scourge slicing through his flesh, the thorns penetrating his scalp, the nails piercing his hands and feet, and the spear plunging through his side into his heart. See the soldiers gambling for his clothes while he hung naked before the world. And then ask yourself, why? Why when the world rejected him? Why when the world said no to him? Why when the world crucified him? Did he continue to the very end? What motivated Jesus to endure the shame and the suffering? Here's the answer. L-O-V-E.
Amen.
Love. By the way, and thank God, love doesn't necessarily consider the worth of the one being loved. In truth, love is best displayed when its object is not deserving. The scripture says, love covers a multitude of sin, or by paraphrase, love overlooks the distractions and disappointments, the refusals and rejection, the faults and the failures to meet the needs. So what will keep you and what will keep me on the path of success is to be motivated by love. We must, as Jesus loved the Father, as Jesus loved the sheep and gave himself for them, we must love Jesus and love those whom Jesus loves. You remember the question presented to Jesus during his final week before crucifixion in Matthew 22? Master, which is the greatest commandment? Jesus answered, love the Lord your God. That's where it begins. With all your heart, that is all your emotion, with all your soul, with all your spirit, with all your mind, with all your intellect. And then he added, and love your neighbor as yourself. And he said, keep these two commandments, and you will be successful in your service to the Master. The third principle. If you will succeed in life and ministry, you must anticipate the enemies in life. And supper being ended, the devil having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus knew the heart of Judas. And he announced that one among the 12 that night would betray him. In the story that follows, Judas, possessed and prompted by the devil, goes to the Sanhedrin council and he sells out the Lord for 30 pieces of silver. He would later betray his master with the kiss of dad. Now one might expect the Son of God to experience the assault, the attack of the enemy. And you would be right. But do you know that Christians are also targets of those under the command of the devil? Jesus told Peter, "Peter, Satan had the desire to sift you like wheat." And what you must know is Satan's desire for you and me is to ruin our lives. He lives every day of his existence devising and implementing some plan to destroy the child of God. Peter warns believers, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, is a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. Keep your eyes open. Watch for the approach of the enemy. Guard your heart, not giving the devil any room to operate in your life. The Apostle Paul affirmed the devil's strategy used to defeat the believer in 2 Corinthians 2:11. Lest Satan should get an advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. Don't fall prey to the temptations of the world. Don't allow the allure of the flesh to captivate your mind and consume your heart. Follow the admonition. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you.
Amen.
And know this, the most deadly enemy of the Christian is the enemy you don't recognize. Be careful of the Judases in your life. As a pastor for nearly 50 years, it has not been the visible assault of Satan that has wounded me. It has not been the attack of the world that has pierced my soul, but the attack of the unexpected, unseen enemy of the faith, the enemy from within. All I'm saying is, beware the enemy. Now the fourth principle. If you will succeed in life and ministry, you must acknowledge the expectations of the Lord. Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hand, and that he was come from God and went to God. In the face of everything Jesus went through, he never gave up, and he never gave in. Understanding that success was measured as a divine perspective. It was God who called him. And it would be God to whom he would not answer. Guys, your primary purpose is to serve the Lord God. Amen?
Amen?
God has called you, commissioned you, and one day, like it or not, you will be confronted by God for what you have done or have not done. In the parable of the stewards, and this is the Reader's Digest version, the ruler left three men in charge of his kingdom. He gave them certain responsibilities to fulfill, promising what? He would come back. And he did. And when he came back, each of the three were summoned into his presence to give an account of their successes or failures. And based on their success or failure, they were rewarded by the ruler. As it was, so it is. Paul writes in Romans 14:12, so then every one of us, you say, us, that's me, every one of us shall give an account of himself to God. I'm not accountable to the world. I'm not even accountable to the church. I am accountable to God.
Right. That's true.
I'm not accountable to you. You're not accountable to me, but we are accountable to the Lord our God. You're not called to fulfill my expectations for you, but your expectations from God. You will not answer to me or anyone else. You will answer to God. Your success or failure will be determined by your faithfulness to the Lord's call upon your life. So know what the Father has called you to do. And determine to be the best that you can be. And oh, by the way, that's all that God asks. Just be the best. Do the best. And then the fifth principle. And this may be the most difficult of all. If you will succeed in life and ministry, you must appropriate the example of the Lord. He rises from supper. And he laid aside his garments. And we're talking about the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the Son of God. And he took a towel. And he girded himself. And then he took and poured water into a basin that he might wash his hands and his face. No. That he might wash the feet, the dirty, stinking feet of the disciples. He said, you call me Master and Lord. And you're right in speaking because that's who I am. If I then, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord, neither he that sent greater than he that sent. I love this. If you know these things and put them into practice, happy are you. On the outskirts of a village, walking down a dusty road, the disciples had entered a discussion. Now, the truth of the matter is they were arguing with one another. The topic? Who will be what? The greatest. Maybe Peter said, well, that's me. I'll be the greatest. I walk on water. John said, I can top that. I am the greatest. I was with the Lord on the Mount of Transfiguration. James cleared his throat and he said, no, guys, it's me. I am the greatest. I was with the Lord when he raised the daughter of Jairus from the dead. And I'm sure every one of the disciples had a reason why they should be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. When Jesus heard their debate, he challenged them. So you want to be great? I think he paused, just looked around at each one of them, and probably restated the question. So you really want to be great in the kingdom of heaven? Then become a servant. Just like me. For even the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and give his life a ransom for many. Here again the words, if I then your Lord and Master have washed your feet, ye also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done. See, as a servant, three things. Your priority in life changes. You exist for someone else. Life is no longer about you. Number two, your plans for life change. You adopt the prayer of the Lord Jesus, not my will, but thine be done. You order your steps by the will of the Father. Third, your praises through life change. See, he gets all the glory. All that you do for the glory of God. Now let me close. Guys, to be successful, well, it starts with salvation. See, none of the above works without a personal relationship with Jesus. Turn from yourself and your sin and trust Jesus as the Lord and Savior of your life. call upon the name of the Lord this morning and be saved.
Yes.
So it starts with salvation. And I strongly encourage you this morning, if you do not have a relationship with the Father through the Son, see the invitation that's about to be given, not as the one given by the pastor to you, but as the invitation given by the Father to you to come and drink of the waters of life. But it continues with selflessness. Not me, but you. And if you, then others. You really want to hear the Lord say, well done? Do you? Do you really want to hear the Lord say, well done? Then make life more about others than it is about you. As a Christian, we exist to serve, not to be served. However, having said that, when this attitude exists among believers, what happens is we serve one another. It starts with salvation, it continues with selflessness, but it finishes with service. You see, it's time to surrender all. To be like Jim and use the time you have. We can't load up on the time machine and go back. That's gone. But every one of us has a future.
Amen.
It's time to serve the Lord. And let me be the good preacher and just add on to that. It's time to be baptized. It's time to become a part of the Lord's church. It's time to use your gifts and talents in the ministry of the King of Kings. It's time to share the gospel with the world around you. It's time. And time starts when? Right now. Today, during the invitation, take whatever steps are necessary to become a successful saint in the service of your Savior. That one who will one day hear from the Father, all this was my beloved child in whom I am well pleased. See, success is not what you think of me. Success is what He says about me.
Amen.
Father, in Jesus' name. Lord, I thank you for the example of Jesus. He has shown us the way to be successful before the Father's eyes. He's given us the courage not to depend on what others think of us and what the world says about us, to be content with what the Father says about us. And Lord, if we've not been made aware of anything else this morning, may it be that the past is gone and what we have is the present, looking to the future. And maybe we didn't do what we should have done in the past. Maybe like Jim, we just turned our backs on you and did things our way, kind of coasted along in our salvation. Knowing we had our ticket punched for heaven, we just didn't want to serve. Lord, may we repent of that attitude and that inactivity. And may we stand before you this morning and say, Lord, I'm sorry for what I didn't do, or I'm sorry for what I did do that I shouldn't have done. But from this day forward, my heart, my soul, my mind, my strength, it's yours. And I will serve you to the best of my ability by the grace of God from this day forward. Lord, may none of us say what I said 40-something years ago. But not tonight, Lord. I'll do it tomorrow. It breaks my heart to think my indecision caused a young man to take his life and go out in eternity I know not where. Lord, Lord, just have your way. God, would you let this day begin be the beginning of a revival of the Family Fellowship Baptist Church. May we walk over one another trying to get to the altar to say, Lord, here am I, I'm yours. Take me, send me. What would you have me to do? Lord, be glorified in our decisions today. Lord, before I finish praying, I want to join Joshua in saying, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm asking you to stand. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Would you come this morning? The altars are open and available. Your pastor's here at the front. Think back, tell you a little story. October 19th, 1976, after a year of fighting God about the call into the ministry, I just finally gave up. And I said, Lord, if you want me, here I am. Down the aisle, presented myself to the pastor, And he said, "What?" He said, "Are you sure God's not calling you into the music ministry?" I said, "Dude, I wish he was." But no, I've tried that. He's not calling me into the music ministry. And for just a few moments, he tried to convince me that God was calling me to do anything other than preach the gospel. I wasn't always the polished individual that you see before you today. But you know something? I am so glad God got his way.
Amen.
The greatest privilege that anyone possesses is the privilege of serving the Savior in the call to the ministry. It is. There's no greater honor. I mean, y'all can do a lot of things, and I'm glad for you, but there is no greater honor than to be the proclaimer of the gospel of Jesus Christ and the shepherd to God's people. And as I've said many times, if I could do something different, guess what? I wouldn't. Yeah, I've had headaches. I've had some issues. I've had some problems. Most of them I caused. But I would not do anything different. Now, I said all of that to preface what I'm about to say. Doug, Cindy, would you come? Now, unlike me, I was a young man. Doug has come this morning. I'm just going to let him share. I'll just put it out there for you. Doug met with me some time back, and he said, "Pastor, I just think God's calling me to the ministry." And like my pastor, I looked at him and I said, "Are you sure?"
Hallelujah.
Amen. And then he said, "But this preaching thing, that's not for me." So he done a little research and he said, "I even talked to an associate pastor," and he said, "I think that's what God's calling me to do. He doesn't have to preach." Well, here's the problem with that. Of course, I've been praying daily for Doug since then. And I've been seeking wisdom, counsel from other state leaders and pastors from around the state. And each one of them has agreed with me. When you answer the call, you answer the call with no strings attached. It's just, "God, if you want me, I'm yours to do what? Whatever you desire." Now, with that said, Doug, would you just take a moment and share with the folks? If you can.
A long, long time now, this has been tugging at me and tugging at me, and I didn't really know what it was, and I didn't know where to go. And so I just been praying about it, and we've been praying about it and talking about it, and just like you said this morning, it just feels like I've just turned 60 years old, and it seems like the first 60 years I've just kind of wasted my time. It seems like that's what I want to do every day. I just want to serve every day, and that's where I'm at in my life. I love the Lord. I love this church. I love all of you very much. I promise you, you're a big part of why I'm standing right here today. I did not grow up in church. My dad was an atheist. My mom never darkened the doors of church. I wasn't raised in church. And just over the last few years, this is just where I'm at. This is my calling. This is what I want to do. I love the Lord. I want to do the Lord's work. And if I say it's too much more, I'm going to cry about it, I think. But, I just have a passion to serve y'all, every one of you. I love all of you. I come here and it just feels like I'm at home. I'm as comfortable here as I am when I'm in the house in my recliner. I just love it here. And I love all of you. And if I look at you, I'm going to cry, so I wouldn't make eye contact with anybody. It's killing me. But that's where I am. And then this morning, the message is just, oh no, this is it. And I just feel like, oh.
It's now or never.
It's now or never. And it was this morning, so. Yeah. I don't know what else to say to that.
Well, amen. I think that's good. Thank you. Amen. In just a moment when we close, please come. They'll be back here to the front. I know it's a young preacher, and it really doesn't matter. The one thing that any person in the gospel ministry must have is encouragement. So you come and just encourage him with these words. Doug, I never thought it would be you. But I want you to know I'm praying for you. And pray for him daily. Okay? That God would use him. He's 60 years old. That doesn't matter. God can use him in a mighty way to make a difference in the world. So if he calls, there's a purpose. And I'm looking forward to seeing what that purpose is. Amen? All right, guys. I can't. Doug's the announcer man. I forgot. So when you get finished, Doug,
okay,
have yourself come up and stand.
Maybe he'll call you to be an announcement guy.
I know. Oh, I love almost everyone here. Family introduction classes. We don't have one scheduled just yet. I don't believe Brother Farrell's left the room, but please, if you're interested in our church and what we're all about, please pick up one of the packets out front at the welcome desk. They're out there available for you. I'm sure someone's out there to pass them out. This is what it looks like if you want to get one of those. Please do that.